families we serve, and it's just such a wonderful time for us. And so I'm so happy that you're able to join us today. Just a few things I want to let you know. If you haven't noticed already, there's some sticky notes on your tables. And for those of you who are in chairs, there's some sticky notes up here at this table. Those are for if you'd ever like to write a story about your loved one, or if you'd like to write a story about your time with us. You can write a little story on it, something simple. It doesn't have to be real elaborate. It's as much as you would feel comfortable writing. And then you can bring it up and stick it on this little board up here and share your story with us. Because we always love to hear your stories and just sharing those memories with you. So please feel free to write that at any time and come post it up. You will walk past this board when we go out to do the butterflies. So if you want to post it up then, that's a good time to do it. Other things I want to say today is just to kind of tell you, like I said, this is my favorite thing I do every year. We also do a candlelight one in the winter, so if you didn't join us last year, you'll get an invite this next winter. So I just hope you can join us again in the winter time. Some of the things you didn't hear from me, some of you guys get phone calls from me, letters, visits. I hope you all take advantage of that, and if there's ever anything you need help with, please feel free to reach out to us. It is always our goal to be there for you and help support you, even after the loss of a loved one. We are always here to help you in any way we can. It is our goal to always be available to you. So please feel free to always call us if there's something you need. If it's just you're struggling and having a hard day, please feel free to call. One of the individuals I'm going to introduce next to you is Juby, who is our director. So I'm going to let her speak next. Juby, you want to come on up?
Morning. I turned out the lights so you can't see the windows too much. And I thought you would be able to see the names of your family members a little better. So thank you for putting up with a little bit of a lower mood light here. So my name is Juby Maggiore, and I am the director of hospice operations for Sarah here in Grand Island. And I have the privilege of working with actually, my employee number just raised to 40 altogether in our office, both full-time, part-time, and casual. So that's a lot of people I have the opportunity to work with. And some of them are here today, and I wanted to introduce them to you. Some of you may know them, and some of you may not. So I'm going to start at the closest end to me, and they're all lined on the wall. And because the lights are low and I'm a tad older, it's pretty hard for me to see in low light. But I see, of course, Stephanie Earl, who is, as she said, our bereavement coordinator. And then that is Stephanie's little girl, who is volunteering for us today. Her name is Chloe. Thank you, Chloe. And next is Melissa Stratton-Schreiner. And Melissa is our social worker, one of our social workers, an excellent social worker, been with us for about 7 years, I think. And she also is a baker extraordinaire. And so all of the cupcakes today are Melissa's. And so you will enjoy them because they put poundage on all of us. So we just wanted to share that grace with you. So anyway, that's Melissa, and she is just wonderful. And today we have with us Sheila Zelazny. And Sheila used to be, she's been all over our Sarah Care in 4 years. She started in Grand Island as a public representative, you know, went out and talked to docs and so on and so forth in the buildings, and then she became our executive director. And then she didn't think that was good enough, and so she left us. And she went over and was Kearney's executive director. And then she became their area, or our area, service representative. And now she's the regional service representative, so she's pretty sharp. And we're very pleased to have known her, if you will. And next to Sheila is Melanie. This is Melanie Nolan, and she is one of our hospice aides. You know, we have 7 aides, usually, and full-time aides, and they're just wonderful. And they are the eyes and the ears for the nurse, and many times for the families of our patients, along with the nurse. And we couldn't do what we do without aides. And any nurse that's telling you the truth will tell you that your life is much easier with a good aide, and we have some great aides. And next to her is another great aide, Susan Steuben. And Sue has been with us for a long time. I was just doing some evals, and I had to see the higher dates, and I think it's been since 2009 or something Susan's been with us. So that's all very exciting. And then farther down in the doorway is Jancy Wendt. Jancy is one of our RNs, and some of you may know her. She does a lot, all over the place. She's been in the northern area that we cover and the southern area we cover and all over Grand Island. So Jancy's just been a doll and very, very flexible, which we really help. And you know, we have 9 nurses. So when I said I have 30 people or 40 people, I mean I have 40 people. And then next to her on the wall there, and where's Susan?
She's out. People came.
People came. So Susan is one of the people that, and she's a nurse, and she is taking some of the registrations. You'll see her. She's got on a blue top. And then that's Dorothy Molchek, who is our chaplain, and she's wonderful. And next to Dorothy is an intern. They like us so well that they actually let us do internships for some of the social worker programs. And Caitlin comes from the University of Nebraska Medical Center, Omaha, University of Nebraska, Omaha, let's say that. I think I'm close. So anyway, so that's some of my staff here today, and they're so happy to be here to be able to see you all again. Those of you that know them, or they know you, or you've heard their names, or talked to them on the phone, and we really appreciate all they do for you, and I know that you have appreciated that also. So, for the most part, I just wanted to tell you a little bit what I know about our program here in Grand Island. In the course of a year, and Stephanie, I want you to correct me, how many patients do we care for and lose in the course of a year?
Today, we're representing 331 for the year.
Okay. So, 331 since last June. And that's a lot of patients. Thank you. And really what we want to thank you for is for choosing hospice, whether it was us or anybody else, because we really feel very strongly that hospice is a tremendous gift to patients and families. And if people would realize what a great benefit they have to be able to have some hospice assistance and not have to always, in some cases, be putting patients in and out and in and out, and I know that's to the hospital, and I know that's a difficult decision. I think that people would feel much better in the long run about how these things go. We have patients on, though, quite frankly, we've had patients that die while we are admitting them, which is sad. We have patients die within hours of our admission, or before the day breaks on the next day of our admission. And then, of course, we have patients that last several days to a week, to weeks, to months. And the hospice benefit says 6 months, and they still don't kick them off because the government knows that you can't determine how long somebody has. So we really appreciate having time to get to know our patients and their families and discover your needs and try to help with those needs and try to make it easier for you when the time comes. And then we have Stephanie to follow up with you and help you find the assistance that you might need after you lose your loved one, because that's always very difficult, and we all know that. So anyway, so I just want to thank you so much for being here today. I want to thank you for choosing AseraCare in whatever way you did. I want to hope that everything that you had hoped for, although we really have high expectations when it's our loved one. I hope that we met most, if not all, of your needs, and certainly all of the patient's needs. And I think that's it. So, thank you. Thank you very much. And we'll move on.
Begins,
We have the names of your loved ones, everyone who has been lost in those last 2 weeks. And attached to their card, there is a butterfly. And so we read the names of those individuals that we have lost in the last 2 weeks. And either myself or someone else in the group gets up and places that butterfly on the tree. And so it varies, but it isn't unusual. By the end of the year, we may have 375 butterflies on the tree. So for every one of us that entered that room, we see the tree. And it reminds us of the privilege of those souls that we have been allowed to care for, whether it's a week, or a day, or 6 months, or a year. And so we never forget. We are constantly reminded that it has been a privilege to serve your family. And each year, it starts over again. We know that for many of you, this has been a time of firsts. My guess is that there are people in this room who have maybe only had to go through one holiday without their family member. For some of you, it may have been several. But it is a time of firsts. And so that you are able to gather with everyone here may also be a first. The funeral is over. You're beginning to adjust to a life without your loved one. And so it may be the first time that you've been able to gather with a room full of other people who are also thinking about this life stage of what it's like to be without the person that they love. We, as workers, acknowledge the fact that initially this loss is a shock. And so when this time comes, we are hoping that what we do today softens the pain just a little. Every year we hold the butterfly memorial, and we all hold dear the symbolism of the butterfly. So in all cultures, across all time, where there are butterflies, it is seen as a time of new life, of transition. And holding it in late spring or early summer, we can all look around as we drive by houses or in our own garden, and the time of tulips and crocuses and iris is gone. And now it gives way to the next lifestyle of the roses and the lilies. And so in this time of year, we look at the fact that life is a progression. And there's beauty each and every season. And now we look forward to the butterflies and what they mean in our garden and what they mean to us as human beings. You know, one time I worked with an individual who really felt that a yellow butterfly was the symbol of her own mother who was coming back to make her presence known to her. And I remember very vividly she told me the story about how she had gone to the Holy Family Shrine. And if any of you have made that trip on the interstate between Lincoln and Omaha, it is so recognizable. You'll see it up on the south side of the interstate. And it is a totally glass building. And it is open to all faiths and all individuals. And it is a place of peace and comfort where each human being can go in there and sit down and pray. And she had done that. She'd gone there to sit and pray for her mother and for the pain that she was feeling and the loss of her mother. And there was a little yellow butterfly. And it kept landing on glass and then taking off. And for her, that was always a symbol that her mother could hear her. And of course, we all have our beliefs about what the next world looks like. We don't really know how it all unfolds. For us in hospice, we have a strong belief that individuals are not alone when they die. that there are other souls, other people they know that come and help them with that journey. So how close our loved one is, what they see, how near they are, what that symbol is, we really don't know. But sometimes people do talk about butterflies and what that means to them. And of course, out in this audience today, we have children. And so when we work with families, it isn't just adults that we think of. And when we find ways to help adults, it's somewhat different than how we help children. So I've invited the children that are here today to draw pictures and to color their butterflies and their caterpillars. And with children in the audience, I would like to tell a story to them, and of course all of you will be able to hear it, of how we help them and explain to them about the transformation from this world to the next. So, I'm going to bring my stool up here, because otherwise I will be so much taller than all the children. So, can those children that have drawn pictures, can you hear me? No? I'm not a very big tech person, so I have to have a tech helper at all times. This one I lived with for 30 years, but okay. So can the children come up? Would that be okay? I know there's more. And if adults have drawn pictures, that's okay too. Hi.
How are you?
Good. Can you tell me your name? This is Owen. And this is Keegan. Oh, Raven. Oh, I'm so sorry. And this is Mackenzie. All right. Are there other children? Oh, thank you. Hi. Hello. This is Maximus and Addie, right? Hi. What's your name? Sophia. And what's your name? Hi. Hi. And Stella? And you are? Okay, come gather around. I need your help. Do you have your pictures? Some of you have pictures, some of you don't, and that's okay. But I'm going to tell you a story today, okay? All right. Once, there was a caterpillar village. You all know what a caterpillar is? They're kind of cute, aren't they? And they're all different colors. Yeah?
No?
Did you, was he fuzzy? Was he a fuzzy caterpillar or was he green? It was green. Wow, that's very big, isn't it? Sometimes they do get really big. Oh, good for you. So you released it to its home, didn't you, by putting it in the grass?
Yeah.
What? Trying to attach itself to the tree, because that's what caterpillars do. So this little caterpillar's name was Charlie. So Charlie the caterpillar loved his life because he had a whole village of other caterpillars. They were his friends and his family, and every day the caterpillars do the same things. They find trees, and they find tall grass, and they find leaves, and they crawl up those until they find the exact right leaf. So does anybody have a caterpillar picture? Can you show it to me? Show it to the people? There's that caterpillar. There's the caterpillar. Yeah. And he looks happy, doesn't he? So Charlie the caterpillar would find the very best leaf to climb up. And he would feed on those tender, tasty leaves.
Now, Charlie loved his family and his friends, and he couldn't imagine a better life, kind of like you guys. So, although everything was perfect, sometimes he would hang upside down from his leaf, and he would see the blue sky, and he would kind of wonder, gosh, what is that? Wonder what that is. Wonder if it's different than what we have here. Then Charlie would notice, and he would talk about it with his village caterpillars, that somebody in the village would go missing. And they couldn't find them. One day it might be Jane, and the next day it might be Ruth, and the next day it might be Fred. And they didn't know where they went, but maybe they had crawled a long ways to find the perfect leaf. And then, one day, Charlie woke up, and he felt different. And something inside of Charlie told him to go and find the best leaf possible. Well, he didn't know what it was all about, but he followed what his heart told him. And he went to this one special place, and he crawled up on it, just like his body told him to do, and all of a sudden, Charlie began to spin a cocoon. Now, you know what a cocoon is? Okay, it kind of looks like, oh, maybe a shell or a pod. And so Charlie began to weave his cocoon. It was small at first, and it got bigger and bigger. And then something told him to crawl inside. And it was so warm, just like your covers are when you go underneath your cover. It was warm and it was comfy, and Charlie didn't once think about his village or if they would worry about him. He just did what his body told him. And so after a period of time, Charlie knew it was time to move. And it was time to break through that cocoon. And so little by little, Charlie came out. And when Charlie came out of that cocoon, what was he? A butterfly. A butterfly. Have any of you ever seen a butterfly?
Yeah.
All right. I know some moths are like butterflies, aren't they? Does anybody have a picture that they can share with everybody of your butterfly?
Oh, nice. Everybody's pictures are so pretty.
So, we change, just like the caterpillar changed to a butterfly. And Charlie spread his wings. And for the first time, Charlie knew what it meant to be like in a new place. He knew what it was like to spread his wings and jump and soar. And he never felt that feeling before, but it was wonderful. Now Charlie would look down on his village. And although he had enjoyed his time there and he loved the little caterpillars there very much, he knew that he would get to see them again when they all turned into butterflies. And that's the end of the butterfly and caterpillar story.
Thank you.
For a reason. For one thing, I think that younger part of us, inside of all of us, who has been through this in the past, watched our parents go through this, knows that there is a transformation. We know it's there, we believe it's there, and ultimately it will bring great peace. But it takes time, because our head and our heart have to catch up with one another. Our head knows that where our loved one is today is a place of total peace and love and glory. But we still yearn and we still miss and we still wish that there was a way to do both at the same time. So I just want you all to know that we here are thinking of you. And it's like Steph said, please reach out. We don't go away. Our office is always there. And sometimes we're there just to listen. So, before I end, I wanted to read you a poem about a butterfly. And I'll back to you.
were all very brave. So thank you.
Just when the weight on my shoulders feels heaviest, just when my world of problems is making me cry, just when the crazies around me are at their craziest, the butterfly flutters by. Just when I reach the end of the rope I hang on to, and when I am ready to ask the good Lord why, just when my head is about to split in two, the butterfly flutters by. And suddenly, the weight is less heavy. No tears do I need to cry. The crazies regain their sanity, and the butterfly winks an eye. The rope is my salvation. The good Lord gives his reply. My head is in one place again. Sing praise to the butterfly. So as you rejoice, we release the butterflies in a little bit. I hope you have the bounty for one to land on your shoulder or in your hair, or just to be able to watch them as they wing their flight. And think of your loved ones, and that they also have gone ahead in their flight. They have winged their flight as well.
Elevators right here, and I'll walk down right over here, the stairs, and just follow us.